The connection between K-theory and Fredholm operators in the beginning, that was the thing which went back some time. It was this work of Jänich on the one hand, and I got a bit involved with the other, and with Kuiper's theorem about the contractibility of the unitary group in Hilbert space, realizing that that K-theory was somehow the universal object for Fredholm operators, or the space of Fredholm operators was the classifying space of K-theory. That wasn't at all clear at the beginning. I mean, you know, when we first started, nothing like that was clear. And I remember partly talking to Palais on the one hand and others, and this picture emerged. And you know, when, at the end of the day, it's extremely simple and very elegant. And I included that in my K-theory notes. So the Fredholm operators ending up as the classifying space of K-theory was a very good thing because, you know, if you were talking to analysts and they wanted to know what K-theory was, you would just explain that if you studied families of Fredholm operators, it was the only topological information, all encoded in the K-theory. So for an analyst, immediately, I remember when I gave Harvard lectures once, Gleason was in the audience and came to these things, and, you know, he immediately sort of really, he'd been working on Hilbert spaces and operators, and he found this very, you know, appealing. So it was a very important link to the analyst, because if you try to explain what K-theory is from the point of view of traditional topology, vector bundles and classifying spaces, and you know, they get no idea, they're lost. I think it was a lot of abstract, complicated stuff. But starting off from the abstract index of operators, it's an extremely obvious thing for a functional analyst. And later on, that became part of general K-theory and so on. So that was a kind of narrow route between algebraic topology on the one side and the functional analysis on the other. And going through that route, you got a good bridge. Well, that was just general relationship between Fredholm operators and K-theory. But then, of course, when you got into the real theory, then you got a much more subtle story because there were all these different other bits you wanted to bring in. And also, even in the complex case, there was a relationship between Fredholm operators and self-adjoint Fredholm operators, which was the model for sort of the odd K-groups. Which is very nice when you see it, and that gives you a nice interpretation with things like the spectral flow and things on the circle, which are also nice from the point of view of analysis. So the use of Fredholm operators and self-adjoint Fredholm operators in relation to families and K-theory was a nice thing, and I learned a lot of operator theory from Singer, and so we worked a lot of this together. And then the last stage of that, really, was this thing you referred to where we did the real case, and then you have eight different cases. And it gets quite delicate, and then you bring in the Clifford algebras as a systematic way of treating all the different classes of Fredholm operators in the different dimensions. And then you actually, we did in that paper produce another proof of the Bott periodicity theorem by a totally different route from anything else done before, which was a kind of big surprise to us because we weren't planning to do that. We were just studying it for this purpose of our applications. And we suddenly realized at the end of the day, well, gosh, somehow we've got the Bott theorem and we didn't use it. Where did it come from? And so we suddenly realized we had a proof. And so we produced this other proof of the Bott periodicity theorem, which incorporates all these different eight cases and things, which is in a way quite natural from the analytical point of view. And I think Dan Quillen has subsequently used that for other purposes. It's a different, really is a different approach to the theorem, and it has its own merits in going off in certain directions.
Yeah.
So but I think it was that whole work on that collection of topics was a combination where Singer's background in operator theory speculative was obviously, you know, very helpful, and I was able to, I learned enough. When you get to learn it, wasn't that difficult, but you had to worry about the continuous spectrum and the singular spectrum and things like that. It worked out very elegantly, and I quite enjoyed that paper too, because again, one of these things were quite tricky and quite subtle, and slightly unexpected results come out.
Yeah.